Good morning, everyone. Hello. Happy Sunday. Week 4 or 5 of Stay at Home. I'm Eric Bloom, your host this morning for Music Mornings, part of the Broad Stage at Home online digital programming initiative. I'm so happy to welcome everyone this morning. We have a really, really special guest, special treat today for our Music Morning show. Today's guest is an international superstar songwriter and musician. He's a multi-platinum selling artist whose career has spanned over 5 decades. An ambassador for peace, his music shares the message of hope that one day we'll all live in a better, more unified world. He's coming to us live from New York right now. I'm so pleased to welcome the incredible Mr. David Broza.
Hello, Eric. Thank you. Hello, everybody.
Hi, David. How are you? Oh, it's an honor for us to have you. You know, I don't know if you know, but my very first favorite musician, who I could say, you know, my favorite artist, he was Billy Joel. I mean, I grew up in London, so Billy Joel was sort of, you know, required learning growing up in Long Island. But my second artist who I could say was my favorite artist was you. As you know, I don't know if I mentioned this one time, but I've been listening to you since I think I was 8 or 9 years old. I learned how to play guitar during summer camp one summer.
This is here in America?
This is here in America, yeah. Because I went to summer camp, Jewish camp, Young Judea, and I wanted to learn how to play guitars around the campfire because I saw what it did. Yeah, Tov was, I think, the second song I learned after Lean On Me. So Lean On Me and then Yeah, Tov.
Amazing. And I know the Young Judea camps because the main one, Tel Yehuda, upstate New York, that actually has a stage and a chair that I signed, that I sat on, like not King Henry VIII, wherever he went, he left a pint of beer for someone. Basically, I've been there a couple of times. They showed me my chair, my signature, my stage. Funny.
I spent many summers at that camp, both as a camper and a counselor. So.
But you know, it's funny, you were saying that I'm ambassador for peace and all this, and that we're all praying to one day be unified. I don't think the world has ever been as unified as it is today in these horrible and difficult and very challenging, this challenging reality. I mean, the coronavirus, this pandemic that we're all dealing with, this has unified the world. I don't think we can ever remember a time when wherever you call, you know you're gonna find your friends at home. And they've been probably quarantined for a good 5 weeks like yourself.
Right.
Whether I call my friends in the south of Spain or in Madrid or in Buenos Aires, Argentina, of course, Tel Aviv, Jerusalem, or wherever in the Middle East, East Jerusalem, you know, everybody has got the same state of mind and living under the same sort of clueless and almost fearful reality. It's a balance between we have no idea where we're going and it's not sure that we will come out of it so quickly, but as long as everybody's healthy around us, then the conversation keeps going in a positive way. And this is the same everywhere. We're as unified as we've ever been.
I agree. I think it's really democratized things in a way because it's affecting everyone. Or will at some point if it hasn't affected.
It's affected. I mean, it's unfolding, and I hope everybody's safe and people are watching, and those who are not so well and are watching in bed, then get well soon, and sending you all the strength through the music, and of course those around you, and the same. I'm lucky, but I've been confined to the house.
So where you're coming to us from New York right now?
Right now I'm in New York. When this whole thing started, I spent half of my time in Tel Aviv, like 10 days in Tel Aviv, 10 days in New York. But when I come to New York, I'm really on tour somewhere in the States. So I'm always performing. So I stop here. That's where my wife's business is. And we're based out of New York and Tel Aviv. But I was here actually in the midst of a tour in the US. Mm. And I was going to spend another month here and then go to Tel Aviv to continue my shows there. Which everything is on hold now. My shows that I was going to do in the States have been pushed to September. Hopefully, we'll they'll take place, and the ones in Israel were pushed to August, hopefully they'll take place, and so on and so forth. But so I've been here just over 5 weeks, probably six yeah. weeks now in the house. For a person that's never been home for more than 2 or 3 days in one stretch, this is an enlightenment, really, because I get to rummage through all the books and through any songs I want to go back to. I have the time now.
Yeah.
But I also find that we start our days later. In a sense, I sleep longer nights, and which I'm not used to at all.
Because you don't have young children at home with you right now.
No, that's the sad thing. You see, when in my age, I'm 64. My oldest is 40. Our youngest is 24. Six kids between my wife and I. Nili Rotano is my wife, and so we share these kids, and all of them are self-sustained in a sense, and yeah. we're in touch with them. Unlike those who want to see their kids already get out of the house and get to do their things, we can't wait to see ours come back and just to see them, look them in the eye, rather than through the Zoom or Facebook or whatever that we're communicating with. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we last saw each other in December after you performed at the Bird Stage in Los Angeles.
Right.
Seems like a lifetime ago. But you know, you mentioned, you know, you're a working artist, you're a professional touring musician. This has obviously impacted you and everybody else in the live performance field directly and drastically. But you mentioned when we were talking earlier that you did a live stream last night for you know, thousands and thousands of people.
Right.
Like trying, you know, you're such a warm and generous performer on stage live. You really develop a intimate relationship with your audience. What's it like trying to develop that relationship this way through the screen?
Well, it was my first try at giving, you know, more than one song to somebody. So I played for an hour and a half. I thought I'd do it in an hour, but there was no way. And so an hour and a half later, I realized that maybe I should limit myself last night to 1.5 hours and come back at a later date. Hopefully there won't be a later date. Hopefully we'll all be out already and enjoying open air activities in our lives. But if it goes on, then I will continue doing these sort of shows. I think I get the feeling or the gist of it more as we go along. I started last night very, very intense and apprehensive as to whether this is working or not. It's like making love on the phone, you know? It's hard. You're playing, and you can't tell whether your partner, which is the audience,
yeah.
is on the same pace as you.
Right.
Forgive me for being in a Sunday morning. Everybody can stretch and just relax.
Right.
It's a new medium, and yeah. I hope to perfect it. And I hope that anything that we say is meaningful to other ears, and not just the conversation that you and I are.
Yeah, I hope so.
As well as the songs, you know, I sing in Hebrew so much. A lot of last night, I basically dedicated almost an entire evening to my Hebrew songs, which I do very often. I think they're beautiful and the melodies are great. Another reason why I do these things is because when I perform in front of an audience that doesn't speak Hebrew, I always remember when I didn't speak English or Spanish or French for that matter, and I still enjoy the music. And then I mimic the sounds of the language, not knowing what I'm saying. Mm. And I think sometimes even when you understand, I don't think anybody can attest that they understood one word of a Bob Dylan concert that they went to, and yet they've enjoyed a tremendous amount of the songs, knowing that they know the songs, but they don't recognize them. Or you go listen to any artist. We don't iterate the words like in theater where every syllable is pronunciated, you know. So I try to enunciate as much as possible, but I know that the music really is what gets the people emotional, and I tend to tell the story a little bit before that, so people don't have to think about what am I singing, you know.
Absolutely.
But I fall into the Hebrew, some of the Spanish songs that I record in the three languages.
So if you're just joining us, this is the Broad Stage at Home Music Morning with our special guest David Broza. If you have questions for David, you can submit them in the comment section on our Facebook live stream. We're going to get to some music here in a second, then we'll come back, we'll talk a little bit more, we'll play a little bit more music, and then we'll see if we can answer some of your questions in the comment section. David, one more thing I wanted to ask you before I turn it over to you. You mentioned you're playing guitar a lot. I know for me, being at home has at times inspired creativity, and at times I haven't been able to think, you know, beyond one thought at a time in my head. Have you been working on anything new? Have you been inspired in this time? Or
so, as far as inspiration goes, I'm not stunned because I'm used to that, but I almost have a writer's block ever since the pandemic started. And I'm not forcing myself to really work at it. You know, I've recorded over 400 recordings, or 500 maybe, to date. So I have a lot of music that I've forgotten over the years. So this is an opportunity to me to refresh and go back to some old, and I'm finding it difficult to remember the words, to relearn the words, whether in the Hebrew or Spanish or English. And secondly, I just finished this past summer, I finished recording my first instrumental album ever in my career, being that I never looked at myself as a guitarist, I'm an accompanist. But a lot of people have over the years said they would like to hear some instrumental pieces of mine, which I've recorded a couple, but never dedicated an entire album to that. And so finally this summer, at the request of a great friend who's the president of a record company that has been releasing my music here, Steve Greenberg from Esker Records, BMG, a very large label company, he asked me to put together an album of instrumental pieces. It took me about 3 years to put it together. So finally, I recorded it in this past summer, and the first single is going to be released on May 1st. It's going to be my first pandemic. And hopefully it will create a new pandemic, like a musical pandemia. It's a beautiful, you know, the album is without one word, you know, it's just guitar music and with a few guests on it, and very well paced and written. You know, I mean, the producer is Javier Limon, who is from Spain, and we recorded it in Madrid. And his work, besides the work that I've done with him, is being with Paco de Lucía, the greatest guitarist, flamenco guitarist to ever have lived, I think. Paco de Lucía and Buica, and a long list of very, very huge artists have come out of Spain. And we decided that we'll work together, and he helped create this beautiful sound for my guitar playing. And I'm beyond thrilled. I'm almost like feeling like I can reissue myself at this very, you know, advanced stage in my career, being over 43, 44 years now on the road, suddenly to indulge in something that is so new to me. And I might play a little piece as introduction. When I warm up a little, it's kind of hard.
That sounds really exciting. I can't wait to hear it. I know everybody wants to hear you play, so we're going to get to some music now.
Yeah.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, if you're watching us and you have some questions for David, please submit them in the comment section. And now, without any further ado, the remarkable Mr. David Broza.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Thank you. לילות שלמים שהיא לא נרדמת על הבקיצי חולמת ובדח כדר עם לרומנטי שמה טובה וחיוך סיפרתי שלוש שנים הוא סובר בשקט כן ובאתי כמעט צועקת ומה עם בעלה יודע מסתירה כותב לך ילדון, גלי מי שולח זה רוח עם סגון שהאביב פורח אם אנשים לכל מובן אם אחר שם עומדת שולח לך זיגה לראות בזה קשור סגון story, as maybe you have guessed, you might have guessed, and it's about a young couple. What they're just saying is about a young couple who are happily married, and they're getting bored with each other. As a matter of fact, she doesn't really know what she found in him in the first place, and starts receiving love letters slipped under her door, which really revives her feelings and romanticism, and she only wishes she could find out who this secret lover is, and after 3 or 4 years of this going on, finds out that, well, she doesn't actually know. The truth is that it's her husband. Anyway, not something recommended to practice at home. But it is a story which has kept audiences at bay. My next song, I'm thinking I'll do a song I wrote with an incredible poet and singer-songwriter in his own right, Pablo Guerrero in Spain. In Madrid, it's called Open the Door, Abre la Puerta. Thank you. ausencia es un cielo negro lleno de barro. Esperas y no sé dónde, en qué momento. Está la ciudad quebrada en mi lamento. Abre la puerta, dame tu llave, abre la puerta. Quiero encontrarte, quiero encontrarte. Abre la puerta, hoy la oscuridad es tu noche abierta. En tu boca duerme el agua que amosa. Pechos de paloma ríen mis manos, vuelan pájaros sin rumbo por tu mirada. Déjame amarte y que llegue la madrugada. Abre la puerta, dame tu llave, abre la puerta. Quiero encontrarte, quiero encontrarte. Abre la puerta, estoy a oscuras, tu noche nadie está. Un océano sin olas, sin ti me siento. Déjame quitar tu ropa, besar tu aliento. Abre la puerta, dame tu llave. Abre la puerta, quiero encontrarte, quiero encontrarte. Abre la puerta, estoy a oscuras, quiero quedarte. Abre la puerta, dame tu llave. Abre la puerta, quiero encontrarte. This was almost of a desperate call for love, the search for love, knowing that she's somewhere and asking her, please open the door, let me in. And I wrote this in Madrid back in 2002 when I was living there and recording my first Spanish albums. This ended up appearing on my third Spanish album called Parking Completo, and which I recorded also with the same producer I just recorded my instrumental album with Javier Limon. It was a great experience. Although we recorded that third album and this particular song in East Jerusalem in a beautiful studio there. So there was almost an underlying story to the making of the album. But there's always underlying stories, just like there is one to writing every song. And when does it come to you? When does the inspiration come? And so you start with writing the song and then producing it, and you never, every phase and every stage has a story. of itself. Let me do now another, get to another song. Song I love to perform. It's from the first album I recorded here in the United States. I've recorded 6 albums here in the States, and all of them are dedicated almost entirely to American poetry. I adapt poems into songs, and I've been doing that for my entire career, whether I'm singing in Hebrew, Spanish, or in English. And this song was inspired by a poem written by the great Alberto Rios, who's a poet laureate of Arizona. Originally, he's from Nogales, right on the border of Arizona and Mexico. He teaches at the University of Arizona in Scottsdale. And we met after having read his books and written music to some of his poems. And we became good friends. And this is, I'm talking about the late 80s. And I released my first album, Away From Home, in 1989. So, and this song was on it. It's the Chileno Boys is basically portraying young fishermen in Chile. What really really attracted me while reading this poem was the fact that Chile was just a side story. It wasn't really the main thing. I think it was the beauty of these young men working menial work, obviously generation upon generation, and yet their dreams are the same dreams as ours here, whether in New York, in Los Angeles, or Tel Aviv, or in south of Spain, or Madrid, Spain. All wanna, dreaming about the women they will have, the families they will create, and the jobs that they will maintain. And so this is, they're not different, you know? Everybody's the same. So here's the Chileno Boys. Chileno boys pull their fish by the fins in the dirt, and they dream about old times and the women they will know, Mariquita and Cas, girls in their dreams of men, when they'll be made.
No,
All right. Where's Eric? Ah, there's Eric. Wow. I can't hear you.
You always got to remember to take off the mute button. it sounds great, I was saying. The sound's coming through crystal clear.
Oh, nice. Thanks.
This is wonderful. We are, once again, if you're just tuning in, you're watching the Broza Stage at Home Music Mornings with our special guest, David Broza. We're going to have a few more songs from David in just a minute, but I wanted to ask you about your charity. I know, you know, music education is very important to you. We've been featuring student musicians on a couple of these programs, and you have a charity called 1 Million Guitars.
That's right. Which,
the mission is to, if I have this, empower children globally through music education. If you're interested in that, you can go to 1millionguitars.org. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, interesting. I didn't even expect that to happen. I have the guitar here. Wait a minute. So here is the guitar. That's one of the 1 million guitars. See? I put a heart in, it's got a heart instead of a hole. So it's a guitar with a heart. In the back it has my autograph, but really it has the motto of the whole thing. I play, therefore I am. And what I do is I design this and manufacture these guitars. And then I donate them to underprivileged areas in the world. Here in the States, we're in touch with organizations like Little Kids Rock and Guitars in the Classroom. And we're in like 43 states, these people are, and giving services to underprivileged children all over the country. I mean, 43 states, thousands of schools. And what they do is that they give music lessons, but they don't necessarily have enough instruments in the classroom. So I'll provide 25 or 30 guitars to every classroom, depending on what they need. Wherever they may be, if it's Arizona, if it's in Wisconsin or New York State or California. I know we're in San Diego, I know we're in LA, and now we're in Israel too. And in all the periphery, like the Jewish towns, the cities, the Arab villages, the Cherkess villages, and these guitars are given to the children of fourth and fifth graders. They get to learn on them for 2 years. At the end of the second year, having proven themselves, you know, that they are really committed to the instrument, which most kids are, they get to take the guitar home forever. That's my gift to them. And so every year I gotta provide more guitars. I go, you know, raising funds from companies and private people. And so far it's been beautiful, successful. We've delivered thousands of guitars. And thank you for even mentioning it. It's a perfectly great guitar, great sound, and I love it. And it looks kind of like my guitar, you see?
Classic. Yes.
Beautiful. Yeah. Nice.
So, and how are the students who are enrolled in this now and they're stuck at home, how is that going to impact their studying? Are they able to take any of the instruments home with them during this time? Or
that's the idea. Yeah, the idea is to actually let them take it home. These guitars will be theirs anyway. They'll just have to probably sign a paper or something that they're responsible for it, but we don't really. We're interested in the kid having something to continue having is being occupied, because these, you know, they come from very disturbed areas, wherever they are, and backgrounds. But even not, you know, even from privileged families, you have kids who just need some kind of guidance. And we also teach the guitar lessons. We also are now working on putting them on YouTube, on a virtual guitar academy, so that the kids can actually continue. In the summer, we'll start putting up based on the theories and the lessons that Little Kids Rock are doing, and they've given us, and we've translated them to Hebrew and Arabic. So it's really amazing. All over the world, people can follow it. And the idea is just to let them find their voice through the instrument and become great people, whether they're mathematicians or they end up being hairdressers or lawyers or doctors or drivers. It's as long as they have some kind of self-identity, they know that who they are, and they find who they are through art. In my case, through the guitar, but of course, any form of art. I promote the guitar because it's taken me my entire life, you know, since the age of 12. That's all I cared about is my guitar, although I was an artist and painted. But once I learned how to play the guitar, and I taught myself, but once I could command it, it's been my greatest savior, you know?
How long did that take you to command the guitar?
Depends on what levels we're talking about. As you can see, after 43-year career, I'm putting out my first instrumental album now. This coming in June, and in May will be my first single, my first song that I'm exposing myself just as a guitarist. So now I can say I probably command as much as I will ever command my guitar. But to really start, you know, when I was 22, I got my first record deal. I think by then I was considered as one who can command. When you ask me when I felt that I did, it took 30 years.
Yeah.
When other people considered me able, no time at all. Because in rock and roll, I'm not a classical guitarist, so I don't have to play by anyone's standards.
Right.
I play by my own, and if it's good enough, strumming, but I never was. I was always a picker. I was always a guitar, you know. Even when I play my what I call country and West Bank music, you know, like when I do children's songs like this, finger picking.
That was awesome. You said that was a children's song?
That was a children's song.
Yeah. Whole
an album I recorded when I was 22 with other amazing Israeli artists, with Yonatan Geffen, the poet. He wrote all the words. It's based on a book of his called The 16th Sheep. It's really that song, 16th Sheep, one is about Keves HaShishasa, is about him going to sleep and not being able to fall asleep, as many of us, and he's counting sheep, jumping over the fence. He always falls asleep on the 16th one. So the whole album is based on that, with Yudit Ravitz, an amazing female vocalist in Israel, singer-songwriter, and Gidi Gov, very well-known Israeli artist, amazing too, and Yoni Richter, who I think is one in a generation musician who wrote most of the music. I happen to have written this one, but most of the music to this album written by him, and it's cross-generational since we put it out 40 years ago.
Awesome.
Yeah, keeps going.
It features your signature top of the guitar percussive move.
Well, this is called Thunder and Lightning. So when I do this, I figure that's the thunder.
No, I've never
fast as lightning.
I've never actually seen another guitarist do that. I'm sure they do, but you're
no, right. I guess it's come to me from my neurosis, I guess. You know, I'm Israeli, and the audience over the years since I started performing, I was always very shy, and the audience always very agitated, because we unlike other places in the world, we listen to the news every half hour. We have a news bulletin, and it's always like, and the borders, the tension is rising in the borders with Jordan, the borders with Syria, the borders with Egypt. It's going on for generations. So everybody walks into a show always after a long day with not only own problems, family problems, personal problems, with a news bulletin. They come and they want to relax with an artist, but they're themselves very charged. So I used to think, I've got to do, and I'm performing alone with a guitar in many, many cases and for many years, I used to, I guess, develop all kinds of ways to make the audience jump and pay attention. So I'd play, you know, and I go, oh yeah, and then I continue, you know. Hey, say, and it became like this secondary, almost a nuance that I do. But I use it a lot as a percussion and fill the sound of my one-man performance.
Can you do it in slow motion? Can we see what it looks like in slow motion? Yeah. Nice.
Don't break your nail over it. I broke a lot of nails. I used to bleed after shows for years.
Okay.
Anyway, so
yeah. Before you play the next song, I just wanted, you know, lots of thank yous on the Facebook comment page. People enjoying this. Gregory Dahl asks if you might play something on that wild-looking 12-string guitar.
Oh,
behind you.
Oh, it's a Villette. It's a beautiful instrument. It's called a Villette. It is beautiful. I don't know. I've written many songs on it, but I haven't played it in a long time.
Is that a Spanish guitar? Is that where does that guitar come from?
This is made in Woodstock, New York.
Oh, very cool. Very cool.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, we are here with David Broza. There, Gregory Dahl says, thank you very much, by the way. There's been a request for Sigaliot. So
I opened with Sigaliot.
Oh, Sharon Vidal Cunningham, you missed it, but you know what? But after this broadcast, the whole broadcast will be archived. You can go to our website at thebroadstage.org at home, and you can see it there. That was the very first song that David played.
I'll do another song from that album. I can do a different song from that album.
Great. So maybe a couple more songs. We'll come back. We'll say goodbye. And just want to express our gratitude again for your time and generosity today, David. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, is David Broza.
Well, it's a thrill for me. You know, I've been coming to the Broad Stage Theater for, I think it's 5 years in a row. I didn't really count, but I believe I started with my solo performance probably 5 years ago. And this is part of, I guess, an ongoing tour that I've been having in the United States every year. Since 1995, I've been doing what's called the David Broza Not Exactly Christmas Show on Christmas Eve in New York City. And then when the Broad Stage invited me to play in their theater, I came around that time of year, around the Christmas time, and it occurred to me when I finished the show that maybe we could make this into an annual performance, which it has become. So ever since I've been coming year after year with different bands, different musicians with me, sometimes more, sometimes less, and doing my not exactly Christmas show. And I fell in love. First time I came to the Broad Stage Theater, I fell in love with it. One of the finest places to perform in. Great stage, beautiful hall. The crew that tends to be like the top professionals and makes you feel like you can really put out your best there. So it's been a great experience, and hence, I guess, my performance today. This song that I will do is the title song from the same album as Sigaliot, Saisha Shiiti, The Woman by My Side. It's one of the most beautiful, I can say, ballads, serenades one could sing to the person you love. And here you he who sings and expresses his utmost love and appreciation and admiration for the woman he loves. And if it's a woman, it'll be the man you love. Or if it's a man, whoever you love, this is that song you want to sing. But the punchline is that at the end of the song, you ask that nobody tell him or her how much you actually are infatuated with them and love them. So it goes like this.
Thank you.
I love that one. I love them all. What can I say? David,
well, I got a couple more songs for you.
So we can't wait to hear them. There's been a request, obviously, for Yia Tov. I'm sure
okay.
You're probably considering playing that one.
Of course.
but I think we'll just, Gregory Dahl says, Viva David Broza. So I think, you know, we're getting towards the end, so we're going to just sort of thank everyone for tuning in. David's going to play maybe one or two more songs to take us out. You're watching TBS, the Broza Stage at Home Music Mornings. Tune in next Saturday night for our Poetry Hour with Red Hen Press at 8 o'clock. And David, it's been just an absolute honor to spend this time with you this morning. So
thank
grateful
you.
For your time and generosity and amazing talent. Anything you'd like to tell us before you play the last couple songs?
Oh, there's so much I want to tell you. I just really, the most important thing is that just stay healthy and keep your spirits up. You know, follow the directions we're getting. Stay away and
stay home.
Just wash your hands. I mean, everybody's gone through this drill so many times, I don't want to repeat it. But
yeah.
The most important thing is keep your spirits up because I think for the first time, if I read right, this is the first time there has been a pandemic and an epidemic where the whole world is kind of going through the same motion and sharing information and slowly applying by the same rules in trying to control it. It has never happened before. There never was probably a need for it to this degree. Although the last epidemic, what was it, the SARS or something, it was in 2012, was horrendous. We didn't really know much about it. I think the world wasn't really in tune the way we are today. So let's hope we'll get through it. I know we will. And meantime, we're here to sing songs. I know so many of my colleagues and artists that I look up at and artists that I admire have been up to this challenge of performing and playing their songs. And it's, I think maybe that's a little bit of a good feeling for all of it. I know that it has given me a lot of uplift. So my next song is a song that was recorded in one of my sunrise concerts in Masada. As a matter of fact, in my first one in 1993. It's called Under the Sky, Mitachat HaShamayim, which I co-wrote with my good friend, the late Meir Ariel, one of the greatest singer-songwriters and inventor of the Israeli language, in a way. You know, as some of his incredible sayings through his poetry have become just the slang or daily use in Israeli, in the Hebrew language as we speak. But enough of all that, I'm just going to sing the song. Anu l'cha shamayim shnayim kmo zuleyim yesh lanu zman tachat shamayim beinatayim anu kan atvani So, hope you're feeling good. Hope you're feeling great. Hope this has been a good hour. I'm gonna, I guess, finish now with one song that you've been asking for, but also the second song that Eric, who just interviewed me, learned. Yatov, things will be better. I've been singing this right from the start of my career, 43 years now. Last count, I haven't counted how many times, but I suspect it's about 10,000 times that I've sung it. And every time I sing it, it just hits me as how relevant it is to no matter what situation I'm singing in. Because that line, things will be better, can work for anybody at any time, at any given moment. So I do wish it upon all of us, all of you, everybody who's tuned in, and those who are not even tuned in don't even know that we're singing right now. Things will be better. Granted. אני מביט מהחלון, זה עושה לי די עצור. האביב חלף עבר, מי יודע אם ישו. הליצן היה למלך, תביא לי הליצן, ושכחתי את הדרך. אבל אני עוד כאן, olive trees, and the children will grow up knowing no more wars, no terror, no frontiers, no viruses, hopefully. And that fresh new grass will grow over the graveyards for love and peace. But after 100 years of war, we haven't and will not lose hope. Oh, Nilma, lichyot biyachad. Tchushot tzeiti, yeladim yichyu bli pachad, bli gvulot, bli mikvah. that I'm climbing the flag, I'm missing the shalom.
Thank you so much, David Broza. Yetov, it will be good. It will be better. Keep believing in that, everyone. David, thank you so much. We will look forward to seeing you in Los Angeles again as soon as possible. And take care of yourself and your family.
Have a wonderful day. Thank you.
You too.
Bye.
And to all those watching today, thank you so much. It will be better. Tune in Saturday night for the Red Hand Poetry Hour at 8 p.m. on these same channels. Thank you for joining us today. Thank you to David Broza, and have a wonderful rest of your Sunday. Bye-bye.